our lecture we're having on our seminar series on hard SQL databases. We're super excited to have the guys from Scream today. So Aran is and Jake are some of the early developers and lead developers working on the system. So Scream is originally founded in Israel. They are headquartered in New York City. Aran is in Denmark, and Jake is in England. So they're all over the map. So we're super excited to have them talk about their GPU database they've been building. So take it away. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. So we titled this talk Bigger Data on GPUs, Approaches, Challenges, and Successes. That's primarily what Jake will be talking about. I'm today a little bit more on the marketing side. You know, Scream is not a huge company. We're not hundreds of thousands of people, or even 1,000, right? So a lot of people do a lot of things. So I focus a lot on marketing today, but I am one of the original developers working underneath Jake. So I'm going to tell you a tiny bit about the product, just so that you have kind of an understanding about what we're going to be talking about. And then I'll hand it over to Jake to talk details and nitty gritty. So our product is called ScreamDB, very creatively named. It is a GPU accelerated data warehouse. What that means is, you know, data warehouse, I'm assuming you all know, GPU is the graphical processing unit, and we use that to accelerate our stuff. This is very marketing-y, so bear with me. Our customers, on average, will analyze about 20 times more data. We found that with the appetite, with the ability to analyze more data, the appetite grows. So when I say 20 times more data, I mean when we come in for a project, and the project says, oh, we're going to be looking at 50 terabytes, we end up sometimes doing 500 and a petabyte and so on. So our projects grow because that appetite for data is real and it is there. Our queries will run about 100 times faster. That's not a mistake, and that's not up to. That's about an average. We have situations where we are 1,680 times faster. There are situations where we'll be a little bit less than 100, but that's like about the average case. I didn't put 1,680x here because that almost doesn't sound believable, but it's true, and we can share some references in the future. Well, and 1,680 is faster than Oracle.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a good distinction. And it will cost about 10%. That's not just the monetary cost, but it's the entire solution. When we're looking at very big databases, they come typically. They need a lot of cooling, they need a lot of electricity, and there's a whole lot going on. And when we say 10%, that relates to all of that. Being an SQL database, which is an important thing that I didn't actually say, it means it can fit in anything. This is not, I'm not trying to sell to you, so just know it's an SQL database. It will fit in where other SQL databases work, run on a variety of infrastructure. The only hard requirement we have for running ScreamDB is an NVIDIA GPU inside. The main ideas behind the product initially was, in order to make an efficient database that people will want to use, you want to be able to get data fast out of the system, right? This should actually say in. I'm sorry about that. This should say fast to get data in. So we use the GPUs for a lot of stuff. We use it for loading. The incredible memory bandwidth of a GPU, nearly 1 terabyte per second, is incredibly efficient and incredibly useful for loading data in. And this is correct. This does say fast to get data out. We want to make getting data out very, very easy. I don't really want to talk about these things. They're just kind of, you know, in general. I want Jake to talk about how we approached this and what we actually did. So I'll hand over the microphone. There you go.
Hi, so I'm Jay Wheat. I'm the lead programmer at Scream, and today I'm going to talk about some of the history of Scream, how we got to where we were, some of the direction changes. Okay. All right. So the first question we had to ask is, are GPUs running interesting for running SQL? We want to know, can you even run SQL on GPUs? Will they run it quickly? Are there some other issues that we need to deal with? So that was our starting point. Can you run SQL on GPUs? So early on, we found a library called Thrust from NVIDIA, which runs on GPUs. And if you look at some typical physical operators from a SQL query engine, you can see a lot of them correspond very closely to single functions in this Thrust library. So we can implement a fair bit of SQL very straightforwardly using this library to run on GPUs straight away.
What is Thrust, like pandas from NVIDIA, or what is it?
It's kind of a bit like SDL. So you've got like an iterator-based data structures and then algorithms that you run on them. These are the algorithms that you can run. So you can immediately transition over to GPU programming using all your knowledge of how to write SDL code in C++. So a naive way to write a GPU-based DBMS is to take all your regular external versions of these operators running on the CPU and just replace the inner parts with these GPU implementations instead. And that's what we did, and it worked very well. We had other issues early on. A lot of people told us the PCR bottleneck from getting data from the CPU onto the GPU means that it'll never run quickly. We heard from a number of customers that they said they heard columnar databases can't do joins. What uses a database without joins? We've heard that people said that GPUs are useful for a number of different operations. They were very popular for computational biology in the early days, but they can't run SQL. SQL can never be run quickly on the GPU. So we started in 2010. So these aren't such big questions today. GPUs are very well established, but back then, everyone was quite skeptical about them. And especially back in 2010, can you put a GPU in a server in a data center? I don't think anyone was doing it back then. There might have been a few experimental things, but it wasn't standard. So this could have been a big problem for us. And then we heard from a lot of places that GPUs aren't actually faster than CPUs. It's just NVIDIA marketing. There was an interesting paper from Intel explaining how you could, this stuff from NVIDIA talking about the sort speed on Intel CPUs was wrong, and actually Intel CPUs can sort much faster than GPUs. It was very complicated to understand, though. I'm not sure I understood it. And the last one, a generic thing. It's not possible for a startup to make a production-ready SQL DBMS. That's a big engineering effort, and no one will really believe that we can do it. Again, this is a less controversial thing now today. We've had a lot of new database management systems in the last 5 years. And some more issues we had. Can you make a convincing demo? Can you do a proof of concept to see if the performance is good? How can you do that? Can you actually turn it into a real product? It's fine if you can run some sample SQL in a POC quickly, but to deploy a production database management system, you need a lot of extra stuff. You need a lot of stability that you don't need in a POC. We already talked about if you can put a GPU in a data center. And our GPUs are going to stick around. In 2010, it was early days for general purpose GPU programming. It was quite niche. No one was sure whether it was going to grow or not. We got very lucky. Now it's very, very conventional. Everyone's doing it. There's GPUs everywhere. It's very fashionable.
We have a lot of people to thank for that.
Yeah.
Gamers and
the gamers made the GPUs cheap enough to build at scale, and then all these other people adopted it and put it in the data centers and made it acceptable to businesses.
And the Bitcoin miners, right?
They're
good people.
Well, they bought all the GPUs and caused a problem, but now there's a slump and you can get the GPUs nice and cheap. It's good for everyone. So next we're going to talk about a bit of inspiration. I wasn't a database programmer when I started. I didn't know what I was doing. I wasn't a GPU programmer either. So we did some early research, found this MonoDB times 100 talk, which is, I think, a great resource, understands columnar databases. So a couple of really interesting papers about running SQL on GPU that were written, I think, in 2008 or 2009. And the basic concept there is GPU programming is very complicated. On the lower levels, there's a lot of stuff to deal with compared to CPUs. But you can build a number of primitives which are a little bit lower level than the physical operators in a typical SQL DBMS. Things like prefix scan and scatter and gather. And on top of those, you can build your physical operators for your SQL database engine. And this is what we used as our approach before we found Thrust, which allowed us to operate on a higher level. And if you look into the implementation of Thrust, it's using a lot of these ideas. So it's nothing specific to SQL. It's a good approach to any sort of coding on a GPU. And there were a lot of papers from a guy called Daniel Abadie. I think you must know him. He's talking about how to make columnar databases efficient, lots of stuff about compression and things like that. And all this generic stuff on columnar databases transfers very straightforwardly to GPUs. So all your GPU code has to work on columnar oriented data anyway. So there wasn't a lot of difference there between a CPU approach and a GPU approach, just plugging in some different functions at the bottom layer. So our original prototype that we decided to build for Scream was OpenCL plus Erlang plus Haskell, and we were going to run it on streaming IoT, which was fashionable at the time. We spent some time working on this. We produced a prototype. We couldn't really find a compelling business case for it. We couldn't find a good product that we could sell. So we kind of thought about that, and we looked into alternatives. We dropped Erlang. We couldn't find an easy way to make Erlang run efficiently and keep the reliability benefits and other benefits of Erlang. But we kept a lot of principles from Erlang. We use Erlang-inspired message passing in the product today, for instance. We were also told by a GPU expert that OpenCL is a bad idea. We should be using CUDA instead. Some of the reasons for that is that CUDA's faster, it's got more features, it's got more support. The big potential benefit to OpenCL is you can run it on ATI graphics cards as well. But at the time, the offering wasn't production ready, the drivers were unstable, no one was using it. And I'm not sure it's changed that much yet, and hopefully it will change in the future. I think people are porting Thrust to OpenCL now, and hopefully we'll see that running on ATI graphics cards.
I'd say the biggest change, it's not called ATI anymore, it's AMD.
AMD, oh yeah. Well, it wasn't called ATI back then, but it was already bought. So our next approach was we discovered Thrust, built a prototype using Haskell. We were generating CUDA source, which contained the causeless Thrust. We managed to create quite an interesting little prototype. We could run a lot of TPCH queries, and it was a very useful prototype to run. But we had a few problems, a few limitations with that. One of the limitations at the time is we could only run queries where we could fit all the data, all the intermediate results and all the output on the GPU at the same time, which was very limiting. The GPU memory was even less back then it is now. I think back then it was typical to see GPUs with 2 or 4 gigabytes of memory, which doesn't give you a lot of space to move, even today. What are the biggest GPUs today? 32 gigabytes?
For the Tesla, it's 32 gigabytes.
So it's not much data to play with. And we were generating the CUDA source at query time. Then we had to pass that through the CUDA compiler, and that was very, very slow. So if you had one sort call on CUDA, it could take 2 to 4 minutes to compile. So a complicated query could take 15 minutes to compile. Now, if you expect the query to take 5 seconds to run, that's not very good. but we learned a lot from doing this, and we used the approach in a later code. Our next product idea was to create a plugin for SQL Server. This was a lot more interesting. We thought, you have a plugin for SQL Server, you're running your SQL Server on your OLTP, and then you want to run some analytics on that as well. SQL Server's too slow for that. We'll just create a plugin. You run your analytic queries on the plugin and carry on running your usual OLTP on SQL Server. And we liked this idea, and we tried to make it work, and we just couldn't get data out of SQL Server fast enough. What we found is that whatever query we had, if we tried to read the base data out of SQL Server to pass onto our engine, it would take longer than running the full query on SQL Server, and that's even with very complicated queries. I think the base reason for that is obviously for analytic queries, you want a columnar storage, and SQL Server just can't produce the data fast enough. So we liked that idea, but we couldn't make it work, so we dropped it. So we finally came around to deciding that we needed to build our own complete DBMS with its full storage layer. It's not GPU programming, but that's what we had to do. So our first DBMS that we built, we had our data on disk. We could run a number of different SQL queries. We could run DDL, insert. We could run a wide range of queries. We had lots of external algorithms, which is a differentiator from us from other GPU databases. Right from day one, we were trying to run queries on data that would only fit on disk, but accelerating it using the GPU. So,
what was the time frame of this one?
This was quite early on. I think this would have been around 2011, 2012. And the architecture of this system is we built a lot of the server in Haskell. We were parsing SQL and compiling the statements in Haskell. We're running a network server in Haskell. We're running a lot of the physical operators in Haskell, reading data from disk. And we just had a few bits of code implemented in C++ and CUDA to do some of the heavy lifting. We had a few limitations with this engine that were a problem. We could run some queries on external data, but not every query. Some of them would run out of memory and fail. But we had a lot of no limits right from the start. We could have any nesting of subqueries. We could have any number of joins. And that was really the starting point of what we have today. After that, we moved on to, before we do that, the question we asked ourselves, the question a lot of people asked, including investors, why don't we just build on Postgres? Why don't we build a Postgres plugin? Why don't we do a fork of Postgres? So there's a lot of upsides to Postgres and a lot of downsides. There are a few things that you might think that Postgres should give us, might give a lot of benefits, but we had a Haskell SQL parse and statement compiler, which we were able to put together a simple query engine, make it all work quite quickly. So we didn't need Postgres for that. And there's a lot of limitations with Postgres. Not only is it a big learning curve to figure out how to do Postgres, it's got its own focus. It's focused on OLTP. It doesn't support distributed. It doesn't support columnar data on storage and no columnar engine. It doesn't have support for threads. Doesn't have support for distributed. So we made the judgment call to not consider building on Postgres, that we will build our own engine from scratch from day one. There are some things that we do miss from Postgres. I think particularly, I thought we missed a cost-based optimizer, but I found out today that maybe the cost-based optimizer isn't amazing. We do miss, if we had a protocol and client compatibility with Postgres, that would open up a lot of SQL tools that we could use straightforwardly. This is something that we can do without building on Postgres. Other people have done that. It's quite common for people to do a Postgres compatible protocol or a MySQL compatible protocol. So that's something that we're still considering doing. So we upgraded our last engine. We've got a mini architecture diagram here. We relegated the Haskell to just compiling the statements. We built a full runtime in C++ and CUDA. We introduced a proper storage engine. We had a metadata database and a bulk storage layer split. There's not too much to say about that. And then after that, this is a diagram of the system we have today. It's quite simple. We're still sticking with the Haskell statement compiler. We have an execution engine where we use lots of small building blocks written in C++ and CUDA, which do heavy lifting. We hook that together. We implement concurrency using queues, and we have these things called task runners, which allow us to tune the amount of concurrency in different parts of the system. For the GPU, what we typically do is we have a GPU task queue. We have every task will need a certain amount of GPU memory, and all we do is we look at the three GPUs on the system, and when one has enough memory, we start running that task. So all we do to manage this, the concurrency on the GPU, is to see if there's enough memory available. We don't worry about tuning the amount of concurrent action on the GPU. We've built a metadata database. It's mostly using built on LevelDB at the moment, so we reuse that. There's a few sort of low-level transactional things that we leverage in LevelDB. We can run that in process or as a separate server, which is how we implement our cluster. And then we have a bulk data layer, which is append only. So it's a slightly unconventional design. With the append only bulk data layer, we do like a background reorganization. So we can do small inserts, write them to disk, support full transactions, and then later on in the background, we reorganize that data into more bulk, which is what we need to do to get good I/O performance and good GPU performance. In our statement compiler, which...
Yeah, what about low-level stages?
The low-level stages. Yeah. So I'll talk about the statement compiler. This bit's all Haskell. So we have a SQL parser in Haskell. Then we do something called desugaring and optimizing. We want to turn the SQL into something that looks more like relational algebra, and then we can straightforwardly translate into relational algebra. And then on the relational algebra layer, we do lots of optimizations, because that's like a nice, simple, high-level view that's very easy to work with. We do a bunch of low-level stages. We have some optimizations that don't fit in with relational algebra, so we create a kind of a low-level representation. I think the key things we do at this stage is we're looking at choosing what kind of join. We're making the sorting explicit. I think in the relational algebra we have expression trees for the select lists, and then in the lower levels we're breaking that into like a list of instructions, and then we produce this query plan which then gets passed to the C++ engine. And our query plan is actually very high level. It's like an interpreter, because we're running on such bulk data, we don't get any of this so-called interpret overhead, because one interpret instruction will then be run on say 1 or 10 million rows at a time. So that's a little different from some other systems, which we'll be doing using LLVM or compiling to bytecode. We don't do any of that at the moment.
Are you doing like the vectorwise, the MariaDB, like you have pre-compiled like functions and primitives that you build with those things, or is it just literally interpretation of the whole thing?
It's kind of like a lot of pre-compiled little components.
Okay.
So say for select lists, we've got a plus function and a string length function, and then we call them in sequence, and then we have a generic sort where we tell it what the keys and the values are, and it runs, which was a little bit tricky to run on the GPU. And then we have a few other little bits that we run. So there's some principles that run through this system. We have a divide between the Haskell and the C++ code. So the C++ code is very much focused on heavy lifting and high performance. It's not designed to be very clever, to make decisions, or to make it easy to use. It just says, give me this exact data and I'll run this operation on it really quickly, or this series of operations. And then we put the intelligence in how that's put together in the Haskell. And that gives us a lot of flexibility. We can try experiments quicker. It's the same amount of code in Haskell is a few lines. It can be hundreds of lines in C++. So if you want to change it, it's much quicker to change, as we introduce much less bugs. We have a small downside to this, which is that it makes it a little bit more difficult for the C++ developers to work independently. So when they're developing new code, they need a bit too much support from the Haskell developers at the moment. So it's a little bit tricky to organize. It can slow them down sometimes, but it's a trade-off, I think, that works well. We have a lot of concurrency in the system. It's all based around message passing. So this is a bit of the Erlang influence. We don't use message passing to pass the bulk data, but just the instructions. So the bulk data is using like a shared memory concept. We use worker pools and like a limited pool of memory, which allows us to control the amount of concurrency to make it optimal, implement back pressure ideas and things like that. We're very aggressive about using bulk data, bulk memory. If we're running something that needs a spool, like a sort, we want to use as much of the CPU memory as possible to spool the data instead of spooling small amounts of disk and running off the disk. And then we're obviously, when we're running on that data, we're trying to operate it in chunks on the GPU. So we've got like a two-stage thing. So in a typical database, you might have we call a K-way sort, where you've got you're sorting single buffers in memory one at a time and writing them to disk and then merging all the buffers from disk. Well, we do the same thing with the GPU compared to the CPU memory. We're sorting small chunks on the GPU and then trying to merge them in memory, and then before we write them to disk and then merge them from disk. Like I say, our storage is a slightly unusual kind of append-only system. We don't overwrite any of the bulk data on the system. We're append-only. This helps us. We have serializable transactions, and this helps us with that implementation. We do a lot of background reorganization of that data. So when you're inserting data, you're going to get small chunks on disk, and this isn't good for performance when we're querying it. So in the background, they'll be combined into much bigger chunks transparently. So a bit more about the storage layer. So we have a metadata database with relatively conventional transactions, which is a thin layer over LevelDB at the moment, where there's a couple of features of LevelDB that we use for that. We have fully serializable transactions with any kind of statement. We don't support good performance for OLTP style workloads that will run very slowly, but we do very high performance bulk inserts, and we can run that concurrently with DDL and with queries to some extent. We don't have any limitations on the serializability of the transactions from that perspective. So we can run multiple queries concurrently with anything. We can run multiple inserts to the same table at the same time with very high performance, as long as they're bulk inserts, of course. We can't run multiple statements in a single transaction, which is a small limitation that we have at the moment. It's not so important for an analytic database to do that, but it's a small limitation. And we use a coarse-grained knocking system for the other parts. So because the inserts and the queries don't exclude each other, we don't hit locks in that case, and therefore the locks doesn't impact the performance much. So how do we use the GPUs effectively in the system? So the first thing is the GPU code. The main part of GPU code is something called kernels. It's just the name you call the code running on the GPUs. It's got a number of different definitions in high performance computing and mathematics. I couldn't come up with a good one, but it's basically a small bunch of code which runs some operations on a lot of data in parallel. So we want to write good kernels. We want to optimize them. We want to make sure our GPU code is well optimized. But when we were working on this, we actually took a ship quickly approach. We took the basic thrust code, which is optimized for ease of use for the programmer, ease of learning. We just used that, and it worked very well. It ran very fast. And then just gradually, we're replacing that naive code with optimized handwritten kernels, and we've been switching over from Thrust to another library from NVIDIA called Cub, which is very similar, but Thrust is optimized for familiarity and ease of use of a C++ programmer. And it has a few performance implications because of that, but the Cub library is a little bit more difficult to use, but doesn't have any of those performance limitations. There are two big things that we want to do to optimize the GPU usage apart from the kernels, and that's the PCI transfer, which is the big one everyone talks about. You have your data on the CPU, and you want to transfer it to the GPU. It's got to go over the PCI bus, which is often a bottleneck, and you've got to make sure you use that effectively. But the other one is about using GPU memory so if you're doing a sort on a GPU on a lot of data, you've got to load up the data chunk by chunk onto the GPU and sort it. Now, if you're doing small chunks, your sort bandwidth is going to be a lot slower than if you're using big chunks. You're trying to fill up the GPU as much as possible. So it's important to arrange the data in the system in order to try and be using as much of the GPU memory at any one time as possible. We want to re-chunk the chunks. This is good for CPU and I/O, but also critical on a GPU. If you're reading data that's come from storage from a load of small inserts that haven't been reorganized yet, you've got small chunks. Or if you've got a where with low selectivity or a join with low selectivity, you've got small chunks coming out. That's not going to run really fast on the GPU, so we want to spool that together and create big chunks. We want to avoid the PCI transfers where possible. The two very basic techniques there is one is that don't load data onto the GPU, operate on it, load it back to the CPU, and then load it back to the GPU again. You want to keep it on the GPU and do as much work while it's on the GPU as possible. And the other one, which is also obvious but people sometimes miss, is if you don't need to do anything with the data, don't load it onto the GPU. We also run some operations on the CPU in parallel. For instance, gather is a big part of the system. You can run gather very quickly on a GPU, but with a PCI transfer time, it starts to look a lot less interesting. So we can generate we can generate gather indexes on the GPU and then run the gather itself on the CPU in parallel, and do lots of profiling. We use NVIDIA's profiling tools to profile on the GPU. We also have a lot of custom-built profiling into our system. I think it's something that you have to take very seriously in a high-performance DBMS. Can't be an afterthought. And the last one, the big one, partitioning. Partitioning approach for analytics, for distributed databases, for running concurrently on the CPU, exactly the same approach for GPUs. We can run stuff in parallel on a single GPU or run on multiple GPUs if we can partition effectively. So this is an example of the running a join on the GPU. We'll take two blocks, one from each table. We'll sort them both on the GPU, which runs very quickly, and then we'll do a vectored binary search on the GPU to generate our join indexes. And then we can just use this building block. And on top of this, we can build a relatively conventional non-index nested loop join and a sort merge join if we're sorting the two tables entirely. Before we start generating the indexes. And then hash joins, which is one of the challenges we have on the GPU. Everyone's running sorting operations. One of the dogmas on the GPU is if you can build your algorithm on top of a sort, do that, because sort runs very quickly on the GPU. So I asked some NVIDIA experts, can we implement hashing quickly on the GPU? Can we implement a fast hash join on the GPU? They said, probably yes. There's no reason to think that hashing can't run quickly on a GPU. But in practice, the sorting code that you get in Thrust and Cub from NVIDIA has had a great deal of engineering effort put into it from all sorts of people. They've all been contributing. If you want a hash implementation to be competitive with that, you need to put in a lot of effort, and a single company probably isn't going to be able to do that. So we don't do hash joins at the moment. Oh yeah, here we go. Here's an example. We've got a couple of papers on the hashing GPU that are available, and huge numbers of papers on how to do sorting on the GPU. And this also translates to code that's available. So we don't do any hashing.
If you're ever curious about it, the paper that you're citing uses one of my hash tables.
Yeah.
And they didn't do a very good job of translating it to the GPU.
Yeah.
For GPU.
Yeah.
There's probably a factor of two that's just
Yeah. Yeah.
It's not as hard as
yeah. Well, the amount of effort to get hashing working well, we don't know. So it's a bit of a risk. So we did some prototyping. It looked okay, but we don't do any hashing. We might come back to it in the future. We do a lot of hash-based algorithms on the CPU at the moment. But it's interesting if someone can come up with some good hashing. We're not. Well, we have to prioritize, right? Yeah. So this, okay. Well, the sorting works very well, so we're happy with that. So yeah. Well, please give it another go, and we'll have a look at the code. Compression is a big thing. All the typical compression that you would use for columnar databases running on a CPU, these all translate very well to the GPU. They run very quickly. We can compress and decompress very quickly on the GPUs in these. And these obviously give a nice benefit to the PCI transfer time, just like they give a nice benefit in standard columnar databases to the I/O. We wrote all these compression algorithms running on the GPU in-house. There's not much compression out there running on the GPU available. For general data, like typically like long texts, we don't compress on a GPU for that. That's still an open problem how to do that. So we use a standard algorithms for that. We use standard code like Snappy and LZ4, and this helps speed up the I/O, but not the PCI transfer times.
What is P4 plus combos?
We've got dictionary, RLE, delta, and P4, and then you can combine them so you can run, say, delta, then RLE, and then delta again, for instance.
What is
P4
stand for?
It's like partitioned frame of reference.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's like one of the early modern algorithms for high speed CPU compression, and it translates to GPUs quite well. So some final thoughts from me. I think it's very clear that SQL analytics and GPUs are a natural fit. They work very well together. If you look at SQL, it's operating on a lot of stuff in parallel, and that's exactly what the GPU is good at. GPUs can be very effective for big data and external algorithms. Some people might say that you're going to be bottlenecked on I/O or the PCI bus, which happens sometimes, but a lot of the times it doesn't happen. So that works very well for us. And there's lots of exciting work being done in analytics on the GPU that we can take advantage of. We've already got GPUs in our machines, we've got GPU programmers. This is something that we're very well positioned for. Some other non-specific ideas. Haskell is a big positive. I want to recommend Haskell to everyone. Learn a bit of Haskell. If you want to write a SQL parser or a statement compiler or like a query optimizer, not the cost-based optimizer, but the other parts, I think Haskell is very good. Or any language along those lines with algebraic data types. Building a commercial SQL DBMS is very, very difficult. It's a real challenge. It's not like writing web apps, but it's incredibly satisfying. I recommend it. If you want to do something interesting that stimulates you, you've picked the right course to do, the right career path to follow. I think it's great. I was working in web apps and I wanted to do something better. And I didn't expect to be working in database management systems 10 years ago, but it's great. It's completely different. You feel like you're doing something that can make a difference. People like using it, and it's real challenges.
Making a difference.
Thank you. Okay, so I'll hand back to Arnon.
Thanks. All right, so I'm going to go back to almost the marketing stuff again. Sorry. Not sorry, but you know what I mean. We've just yesterday, actually, was it yesterday? I think it was 2 days ago, we announced our availability on IBM Power 9. Now, I don't know if you guys are familiar with IBM Power 9. It's IBM's latest architecture. And what makes it really interesting is NVLink. So I heard this today. NVIDIA call this NVLink, but we call it the missing link. So Jake talked about some of the bottlenecks that we experience with PCI Express. And we do a whole lot of different things to kind of limit the effect of that bottleneck. And IBM with Power9 and NVLink and NVIDIA Tesla GPUs make a great combination together, because that NVLink bus is about 9.5 times more bandwidth than PCI Express, which means that becomes a much smaller problem than it used to be. You can't really see, but each of these servers will have between 2 and 6 NVIDIA Tesla GPUs, which is an immense amount of power for us. Jake didn't really touch on that, and I didn't touch on it either, but we can do an immense amount of work in a relatively small box, and I want to show you what that looks like. But first of all, you know, it's not just the amount of cores in the system. When you see a lot of these GPU kind of talks, they always talk about the amount of cores. it's not just the amount of cores. You can do a whole lot with 5,000 cores, but if you're, you know, if you're bottlenecked in the RAM or if you're bottlenecked with PCI Express, that's a problem. So IBM Power 9 really makes that very, very, it widens that pipe, and we can do so much with that. And not just us, any other company working with Power 9 and NVLink can take advantage of that, and that's pretty great. I was told that no one before us showed any performance numbers, so I'm going to show performance numbers relative to ourselves. So this is some TPCH queries. TPCH query 8, which used to be a PCI Express bottlenecked query for us, used to take about 52 seconds on 10 terabytes of data. So this query on a scale factor of 10,000, which means 10 terabytes of data, would take about 52 seconds. And this is on a modern Intel box with Skylake and the latest generation NVIDIA Tesla V100s. And with Power 9, we can get that down to 14 without having touched the code at all. All we had to do was compile our code for Power 9. We didn't do any tweaks. We haven't done any improvements. This is just raw performance that we're getting from that enhanced pipeline that we get with NVLink. So that's very exciting for us. That was announced yesterday or 2 days ago. I want to show you a customer project that I worked on. So I was a developer. I mentioned I'm in marketing now, but I also did some deployments. For me as a developer, so I joined Scream as basically still a university student. And I started working on the query compiler under Jake, as I mentioned, writing Haskell without having done any Haskell before, which was extremely challenging for me. But the great satisfaction that I derive is actually not just from working on the product, but it's from seeing people use it and seeing how they use it and seeing their eyes widen up when they finally have that access to all their data. Okay? So this is a company out in Thailand that we work with. They're called AIS. They're the largest operator in Thailand, just over 40 million customers, which is not huge in like China terms, but it's a very big operator. And they approached us because they said, look, we're trying to figure out some information about our customers. We want to know where they hang out. We want to know where they use data. We want to know how their network experience is. And we can't really do that in our current system because it's just so overloaded. So they actually had a Greenplum installation, and they had a pretty big Greenplum installation, and they were showing us how long it takes them to get this. It's not that they can't run it, it's just that it's almost infeasible. So they were showing us, you know, we ingest the data in, it's a nightly process, it takes about 5 hours. It's not just ingest, we're not just copying the data in, we're preparing it for analytics, we're creating these views, we're materializing everything, we're doing all this indexing, and then we're preparing it for reporting. And that reporting still takes about 2 hours. So when we run this query, it's not just one query, it's like a set of 10 queries that run one after the other, a lot of window functions, all that kind of exciting SQL. And that takes about 2 hours. And that's simply not practical for us. And with our system, we showed them how we can prepare the data for analysis in about 20 minutes. Because our brute force approach doesn't require all the indexing and all the materializing that they would have to do on Greenplum. So after 20 minutes of loading, the entire data set is there and it's ready to be queried, which is great. And our query took about 9 minutes and 40 seconds. I rounded it up to 10 because it looks nicer. But 9 minutes and 40 seconds. And they didn't believe us. And they had us run it again and again and change parameters. And now don't look at 1 day, look at 2 days, look at 5 days, look at 11 days, show us different areas, because they didn't believe us. And with all honesty, I wouldn't believe us either. Because when you have a great system that you paid a lot of money for and it takes 2 hours, and then, you know, these couple of Israelis come up and they, I'll show you what the system looks like and you'll understand why they didn't believe us either. But they didn't believe us and we had to run it again and again and again. And they took all the result sets and they put them into Excel. And they took the results from Greenplum, which we had to wait until after lunch for, and they compared them and they went cell by cell to verify them. You know, for understandable reasons. This is the difference in what the solution looked like. So their Greenplum was 80 nodes in 5 racks with about 7,600 CPU nodes. That's their numbers, not mine. I have no idea how to, I can't verify that. I've not seen those servers. What we did is we repurposed one of their old servers and we brought a GPU with us. We installed it. It took about an hour. Very, very, very cold data center. We installed our software and we started running, and that's all there was to it. The queries translated one-to-one. There was nothing to change. The data loading was the challenging part because we had to take over from their old system. And let me show you what that looks like. So that was their system beforehand. So there's a lot going on here. Important things to note, ETL took about 1 to 2 hours, and the preparation would take another 3 hours. So that's the 5 hours I talked about. That's the preparation time. And then the reports that they would generate over once a month, the fastest report would take about 30 minutes. The slowest report would take about 5 hours. When we brought our system and we said, we don't need all that, let's simplify it, ETL would take 20 minutes total. So we can do this in parallel. So it would take 20 minutes for the entire process. Sorry, this is white text. I didn't see that before. My fault. Monthly reports, right? 30 minutes before, 2 minutes now, 5 hours before, 10 minutes now. That is the immense value that we can bring. And that's why we think it's a compelling product. Not because it's a GPU. The GPU is almost a distraction, right? It sounds sexy, it's great. I wear NVIDIA socks, right? I'm all about that. I like it. I have a Titan in my computer at home. But, you know, if you're just doing technology and it doesn't solve a problem, then it's just that. It's just technology. And we're actually solving some very interesting problems for our customers. And that's what I love about this job. That's why I like working for this company. You know, it's a small company, and there is a benefit to working in a small company because you can do a whole lot of different things and you can get exposed to so many different things. And you travel the world. Like, so I'm from Denmark, Jake is from England, and you know, we move around and we do deployments, and that's pretty great. I love that.
You drove across Pennsylvania from New York.
Yeah, and we drove from New York City yesterday, which took about almost 8 hours total.
I tell them not to do this. They didn't. Yeah. Listen.
No, but we're flying back, so it's okay.
Don't put a GPU in that crap. So
those exist, by the way. NVIDIA's doing a lot with self-driving cars, so that's a very exciting field, by the way, for them.
Does OpenCL compile down? Can you get it compiled to x86, or does it always have to compile to the?
That's a question for you.
What benefit are you getting from going to the GPU versus just being a better architecture, a newer system?
That's a good question. The answer is we've no real idea about that. What comes from our particular architecture, aside from the GPU, and what comes from the GPU itself? It's difficult to say. You don't see any really good comparisons between specific GPU and CPU code. But I think that the GPU is adding a lot. We don't have the resources to try and implement like a full CPU set of code at high performance. I don't even know how you do that. Would you use OpenCL for high performance CPU code? There's a lot of different options there.
I think LLVM would do that.
LLVM, yeah. But you want to get all that vectorization and stuff like that, right?
Yeah. What's that?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. I'm not saying you flip the switch and it magically happens.
I think we get a lot of benefit from Haskell as well because it allows us to do a lot of very aggressive.
Yeah.
We get a lot of very aggressive optimizations from the Haskell, rewriting the trees in a very small amount of code, which allows us to do lots and lots of like very special cases, and we can maintain a great deal of like one-off transformations optimizing particular situations much more easily than
we can add functions to the parser, to the compiler in like a day. That was very common for us. Like one person in a day can add like a bunch of different math functions and date functions and all that kind of different SQL stuff. You can do that, and it's extremely simple, and it's easy to test as well, and you know you're not going to fall in runtime, which is a really big added bonus.
So and then for this POC here, like, yep. you not only replaced GreenPlum, but you also replaced Impala as well.
Impala was used as a separate thing.
Okay, all right.
They were trying Impala as well.
Okay.
I don't know where it is right now, but
okay.
We run a lot faster than a lot of other CPU calling our databases.
Okay.
We've heard that from POCs.
Yeah. I think one of the main things that we would not be able to get otherwise with, like, you know, with CPU is probably the sorting. I think the sorting is almost free on the GPU.
Some people say that.
Yeah, okay.
It's almost free. It runs very fast.
Yeah.
And you can build a lot of algorithms very quickly on top of sorted data. So it's good for trying stuff out.
Wait, is this last slide? Sorry.
Yeah. I'm done. All
right, let's thank him. We have time for a few questions.
How do you shard the data between GPUs or cluster nodes?
Repeat the question.
How do we shard the, or distribute the data between GPUs and cluster nodes? Do you want to take that?
Okay. we don't do a conventional approach to sharding. Our cluster implementation at the moment is based on shared storage. We typically use multiple machines in a cluster to run statements in parallel. So we're not doing a lot of distributed statements at the moment. It's something that we're moving into at the moment. I think we would just use the standard sharding approaches, either sorting or hash-based keys. I don't think it's a lot different for GPUs than it is for a regular cluster.
Do you do think anything special for, like, if you have multiple GPUs in the same box? Is there any magic to that, or just a matter of just scheduling things that go down to different GPUs?
When we have multiple GPUs in one box, there's two ways that we're using at the moment. We can run different queries, different statements on different GPUs, and that's something that we ran a very long time ago that we still use today. It's a minimal amount of extra code to add concurrency to the system. And we also have this GPU task concept where we're posting tasks to a queue, and then they wait in the queue, and then they get run on the GPU one by one, or sometimes if more than one can fit on the GPU at the same time, we just extend that out to distributing it between whatever GPUs are available on that box.
And that scales out as well to other boxes. So because of the centralized storage concept, we can have multiple boxes seeing the same data.
Got it. Okay. And then what happens, like, if you run out of memory in the GPU? Like, does it spill out? Does it crash? Like, because in some ways you have to estimate that. Like, all right, I'm gonna run this operator on the GPU, and I think my input's gonna be this big, my output's gonna be that big, and I have enough space for it. What happens if you get wrong? And
we're conservative, so we don't really have the possibility of getting it wrong. For instance, if we're taking two chunks and we're joining them, the algorithm will output a same size chunk, and if that's not the full join, if that's just part of the join, you get that one chunk, you take it off the GPU, and then you generate the next chunk and take it off the GPU. So it's a particular kind of approach. It's very simple to implement, and it's working pretty well so far. There's a lot more sophisticated things you can do, but yeah. So we avoid all that kind of dynamic stuff. Do we have anything open source? The SQL parser and type checker is open source. That's all.
It's in Haskell.
I think
it is, and yeah, new UHEC. That's still a thing.
It's written in Haskell.
Yeah, it's Haskell. It's well documented though, so it's quite easy to follow if you know a little bit of Haskell.
We'd like to release some more open source stuff, but probably not anything really interesting on the GPU side. Maybe in the future.
You have to understand the amount of of effort that it takes to build that stuff, and you know, just releasing it out into the open is kind of scary for a company that's trying to make money.
All right, any last question? All right, let's thank speakers again. All right, the next talk is in 2 weeks, October 25th. The BlazingDB guys from Texas and Peru are coming, okay? All right, guys, yeah. Have a good weekend.
Don't miss BlazingDB, they're great.
Let's take a trip through the far side and black suits troops the group on the stalk and the uncivilized island of New York where the criminals run the project development through drug spots. I be sleeping through the screens and rapid fire shots. My block consists of multiple juvenile offenders and their crews. I'm telling you, even precincts get dips on these kids making figs. Peep this, Operation Safe Home ain't shit. Giuliani got these perpetrating housing cops on the dicks. Now ain't this a bit